hippopotamus or something, but he's really not that into it. And it was really interesting. And as I left, when I was just there visiting for an hour, he started crying, which really shows you a couple of things. It shows you the thirst for attachment and for the type of trust and things. And actually, one way of thinking about this overall, and this might sound a little bit schmaltzy, but essentially, they have to do with love. They have to do with loving children, responsively interacting with them, feeding them. I mean, what do all those things have in common? And so what Israel had pretty clearly was that's what he was really seen to be lacking. And so you really see a lot. Now, this program is a very high quality, and you can see it in the background behind me there, very high quality creche that combines very high quality child care with nutrition and, trained EC people, et cetera. And it's right in the middle of the swamp. And the idea of this social enterprise, it's called Kadogo, is to link that situation with the situation you see in the bottom slide. Many times you have a very expensive situation of informal caregiving in these slums. So parents go to work in the city. They leave their kids, sometimes about 15 at a time, as you see in the picture, in the care of an informal, completely untrained caregiver. When I visited this one case here, you could see they're kind of sitting in the dark room. They're not playing. Their nutritional standards are not great. So the idea of Kadogo is actually to link the demonstration project right in the same neighborhood, just a block or two away, of very high-quality child care with excellent nutrition and excellent standards in a hub-and-spoke model with many of these situations that you see below, and raise the capacity of that informal caregiver to raise the abilities of the caregiving system generally. And I think, Alan, this is very much along the lines of what you were referring to earlier, but in the context of an extremely impoverished community living in a slum outside of Nairobi. Again, this is a social enterprise, the model is being tested, et cetera. So, I'm exactly on time. I spent 30 minutes talking to you about saving brains and the portfolio, and that leaves us with, I think, about 10 minutes for a good interaction, and would really love your feedback. But just to summarize my key messages. Number one, this problem of child development, call it saving brains, call it children thriving, whatever you like to call it, is perhaps the most fundamental social and economic challenge that we face in the world today, domestically and globally, because the sustainable development goals, of course, are universal, so there's actually no distinction between domestically and globally. And you see the very same types of situations, although maybe with different manifestations, in our own impoverished communities. So this is a huge grand challenge. It's maybe the grandest challenge. Secondly, and that's because the implications are so huge, economically, socially, and in terms of the future health of the children, in terms of their mental health, in terms of obesity, in terms of everything else, non-fatal disease. Secondly, we are at a point where the global policy environment has now started to recognize the relevance of thrival. We've previously been just looking at survival, which I think was really shooting ourselves in the foot globally, because thrival is actually what is most salient for parents. If I said to you, hey, great news, your child has survived, that doesn't really resonate with you. You expect your child to survive. I mean, what every parent wants is for their child to reach her full potential. It's a much more salient argument. So rather than pushing for survival, we can pull the message from thrival, which I think is much more effective at children reaching their full potential. We have a lot of knowledge about this area, including some very important fundamental knowledge that was reviewed through this conference, some of the measuring techniques that are being developed in a Gates sub-challenge here. But the real issue is, how do you translate that knowledge into innovative solutions? And that's where the grand challenge approach really comes in. So then I showed you a portfolio where we actually attempted to do that with $40+ million and 100+ innovative solutions. And we don't expect all of them to succeed, but you can see that many of them are starting to gather the type of evidence that is actually needed to succeed in a local jurisdiction, and it's happening in a community where the knowledge is being shared. So then, if you're starting to develop the evidence on these innovations, the next question becomes, how do you actually scale them in a sustainable manner so that one in three children who do not reach their full potential ultimately will? And that's roughly speaking where this portfolio is at. So my request to you is join us, work with us, look very much forward to your discussion and comments and questions. Thank you very much. Appreciate your attention.
Peter, thank you very much. I think you so well illustrated the way you're looking for innovations in science, in social innovations, in business, in management, and in so many different aspects, and driving those into impact all over the world. So thank you for sharing this experience. We do have some time for questions, so let me open it up to you. Does anybody want to know how to get a hold of Peter? Oh, here we go.
Are there any of you?
So it's a fantastic question. It was really a question of are there any of these programs considering for replication in quote unquote developed countries, should we say? Let me just say this. Every structure, every institutional structure we have in government is set up to prevent that. It's set up to say, here's a funding silo that's called international development, and that's meant for poor kids in poor countries. Here's a funding silo that we have for domestic development, it's called Head Start. That's meant for kids in the United States or kids in Canada. So when you actually try to do that, it's very easy to be dissuaded based on the administrative structures of government. I see that slowly changing. And I see that many of these innovations, and certainly much of this knowledge, is extremely useful domestically in Canada and the United States, including in our Aboriginal communities. I mean, one of the great chains of Canada is the health of Aboriginal children. And this issue of child development and intergenerational poverty, I think, is extremely core. So where have we gotten on that? One example of a project we funded in many several Latin American countries was about screening for hearing loss in very young children, correcting the hearing loss, of course, and preventing the developmental delays. That project, as I mentioned, we funded in Latin American countries, and then a domestic Canadian foundation is in the process of funding it in Aboriginal communities. So that, to me, is absolutely the sweet spot. And think about that in your own situation. I wanted to highlight, though, how difficult that is and how creative our approaches are going to need to be to actually make that happen. But the day when we actually truly see the transferability of innovations, and we've for a long time thought about how our great innovations could be. Thank you.
そっか、散歩どう散歩を思うか。
はい、一応散歩をや
って。あ、違うだ。
そうそう。
あ、大丈夫だ。
お近くのスタッフにお声掛けください。 ご来店いただきまして誠にありがとうございます。当店は夜の11時を待ちまして閉店とさせていただきます。何かお探しのものがございましたら、当店近くまでお気軽にお問い合わせくださいませ。あと夜の11時を過ぎますと当店でマネージャーが停止してしまいます。今回の生産にご協力をお願いいたします。本日も当店にご来店いただきまして誠にありがとうございます。
Comes out of here with a new idea, a new thought, a new way of